You don't want to be known as soft. You don't want to be known as small. You don't want to be known as easy to push around. You know, this is a tough game, and there's a lot of tough guys, and these guys are warriors out on the ice.
Welcome to Between the Hash Marks from the Business of Hockey and the Goal podcast with Richard York and Les Kowalski. Let's start this episode. Welcome to part two, the continuation of last week's episode. Enjoy. The weapon that Brad Treliving used was Mark Giordano's contract, which was for a shave under $7 million a season. And I wanted to talk about the template that he used, and Giordano was his fulcrum, his leverage point. And the two most notable people he had to sign was Johnny Gaudreau and Sean Monahan, who is a first-line winger, and Sean Monahan is the first-line center. Both coming off their entry-level contracts in the same year, Johnny Gaudreau came from Boston, the university program there, so he had a two-year entry-level contract, and Sean Monahan came from the CHL, so he had a three-year entry-level contract. And they both entered their contract year the same time. Brad Treliving had to sign these two superstars at the same time. Cap was a bit tighter back in those days, so it was a little harder. There's lots of people to compare those two guys to in the league, but you saw them going all over the board with who was signed. Some people were signed for too much, some people were signed for too little. Certainly in Calgary, the agents were leveraging for more and more and more. The weapon that Brad Treliving used was Mark Giordano's contract, which was for a shave under $7 million a season. From the outside looking in, the template that he used was Mark Giordano's contract to make sure that the leader on the ice, the leader off the ice, the captain on the ice, the captain off the ice, in the public's eye, in the community, in every way, Mark Giordano was the leader, is that he was also going to be the leading contract. And it was his contract that he used as a cap to sign these two young kids coming off their entry level. Mark Giordano had to prove his worth over and over and over again. He was never drafted. He was given a tryout 2 years after his draft eligibility, and he worked his way up. He absolutely worked his way up, and he had to earn this contract. And he is 36 now or so, I believe, and he is still a workhorse. He still comes to the rink, the one that's in the best shape and conditioning. And, you know, he leads in every aspect, and he had a good mentor in Jerome Iginla as far as how to pass those reins on as captain. And he's the kind of captain that any franchise would want. He's the kind of defenseman that any franchise would want. And Brad Treliving certainly used him as a template, a contract template for the two young kids that he had to sign. And it took a lot of time, it took a lot of negotiating, and it took a lot of leveraging, to the point where even Brad Treliving and Brian Burke himself had to go to Johnny Gaudreau's parents' house to sit and have a face-to-face with the kid and explain to them their financial goals and their business template and what they were doing. But eventually Johnny Gaudreau got on board, and he signed within a week at that point. And both of them signed for under what Giordano was making. It was just a hair, but it was still what they wanted. And they used Giordano's contract as a fulcrum and as a leverage to do that. And I thought that was a pretty good business practice. So I have a good question for you. We see this business practice of Brad Treliving, and we've already discussed his potential business background with his family for sure. Would a contract template or a wage structure template work in real business applications, small business applications, big business, whatever?
I think one of the major issues is when you hire someone, it's really difficult to share the wage value that other employees are making, especially if you have somebody working for you that's been around, let's say, for 10 years, does not have the necessary education someone new coming in may have, but may have 10 years of experience, versus someone only has a theoretical perspective on doing something. There is a merit to creating a contract or wage framework to be able to work off of, to be able to get performance out of somebody. And I've always said that there's merit to this, is to have everything performance-based, or to have incentives. If you bring somebody in and say, we're going to pay you $27 an hour, if you stay and do X, your wage will go up by a dollar. You do Y, go up by another dollar, and it keeps incrementing. It provides a certain level of performance and guarantee and comfort for somebody to be able to move forward. But I think more so, a lot of people, if you can have them share some type of performance bonus as a group or a performance specifically to what they're doing, I think you really need to be able to have incentives for those individuals. You could potentially structure it and say, this is our entry level rates and have that structure. But the danger in that is potentially are going to be at a competitive disadvantage if that information should get out to your competitors. At the end of the day, people are always looking for more money to make, either as a salary or an hourly wage. They always want more. If you've got your competitor down the street who finds out about your open way of doing things and says, this is what you're making, hey, we'll pay you $3 more an hour, $5 more an hour, you come work with us. So I think you can have something like that in business, but I think you really need to have very defined incentives and performance bonuses that people can share in to be able to increase that baseline that they've been given. And I think that's one of the main areas that I think you would have to focus on for something like that to work, regardless if it's a small business or even if it's a large business.
So kind of like a commission bonus, right? Where the...
Oh, I think so. I think
something like that.
Yeah, I think it's, you could have someone be making a salary with whatever they're doing, but I think you want them to have buy-in. Your only way that you're going to do that is I'm not necessarily one to say, I want you to have a profit sharing. There's not many owners that are going to offer the correct structure for profit sharing. And I think that anytime an owner says the word profit sharing, it just gives me the eebie-jeebies when I think about that, because no one wants to share in that. You want them to work for whatever they're getting as that incentive or as that bonus. So you may have structures developed for very specific targets so that they can share in to help grow that business. And it's no different like what you just said. When you look at a weaker organization or smaller team as the Coyotes, or if it's a department in a company, you put your strong management in there and you give them incentives to really make this thing work. I think it's the same thing. It's the same idea as what you're doing from the player side. And if you do put a structure like that in place, then that variable of having the competitor down the street saying, you know what, we're going to give you an extra $2-3, you're not going to necessarily, as an employee, leave because it's that sharing of that incentive. If you have a 30% share of an incentive that, let's say, the profit for a certain initiative is $100,000 and you make $30,000, well, you're going to work your butt off to help make that $30,000 for yourself, even if you're making $27 an hour. If you have that type of structure in place that you can demonstrate, it will keep those people and key people in place so they don't go down there. But I think that if it's not developed in a proper way where it's thought out and that someone could just basically rip it off, I don't think it's going to work.
So if you are going to use a template, it's got to be something that works efficiently from both ends of the spectrum, from the employer end and from the employee.
And that's the main thing, is that you have to have buy-in. An employee is not going to be given shares necessarily in a company. They're not going to be put into top management positions. That's not how it works. And so everybody wants to have high return for their time. You need to be able to have something in place that really defines the value for what you're doing. Just to get a high wage just because you have certain skill sets is, in my books, it's not enough. You have to provide proof of performance. And if you can't perform, why should I be sharing with you $30,000 or 30% of $100,000 just because you showed up? At the end of the day, people that you even hire, it's based on very particular skills that they have, right? You have a defined goal and you're expecting them to achieve or move an organization in a certain direction, but that incentives ensures that they tap into those skills. If you don't provide some type of incentive in that framework, they're not necessarily going to live up to that that level or standard by which you hired them. So if they have a certain set of skills, that gets them through the door and gets them the job, but now you have to have them perform. And so I think you could create a contract framework that works based on a certain level of skill sets that are required. If someone does come in and they want to be making $300,000 a year, they're hired at $27 an hour, you could put a structure in place to make them achieve that. You would have to be very clear what those parameters would be. I think in this day and age, that's what you have to do. I think that's the only way you're going to get people to move an organization forward. And I think you could put something like that in place, even at a junior introductory level.
So it's a good idea to have proof of performance raises is kind of what you're going for, that there has to be incentive to continue to grow, to continue to push, to continue to perform. You can't just roll out the bank to them the moment that they succeed. That's certainly the approach they take in hockey as well, is that you're always debating what is the peak performance of a hockey player and what does he deserve to be paid for? Does he deserve to be paid for that peak, or does he deserve to be paid for the average? So past performance certainly helps when it comes to data collecting as far as a trend and potential ceiling for certain players. And Brad Treliving certainly speaks highly of his two young guns. It's a good segue into the latest contract that he had to sign with his next superstar, which was Matthew Tkachuk. Love him, hate him, he's there to stay. Any fan base and any general manager will tell you that they wish he was on their team. He's the kind of player who performs on both ends of the ice. He scores goals, he helps his teammates, he fights, and he pisses people off. That is what he does. He came up for renewal after his entry-level contract, and it's interesting how Brad Treliving had to adjust his methods because of the league adjusting numbers. So as we know, the cap hit kind of tends to fluctuate year by year. If they have a good year, it goes up a little bit and it goes up a little bit. They had Las Vegas come in, which bumped it up quite a bit, $4 or $5 million, I think, off the top of my head. But it gave them a bit more flexibility in their payroll. So the agent for Matthew Tkachuk and a few other superstars in the league at the time tried to take advantage of the fact that the cap was on an upward trend and try and catch general managers overconfident with the direction of the NHL. And of course, as we know, the COVID-19 thing came around and we have no idea how the cap structure is going to fall into place for next year. It could completely bottom out. They're talking about potentially giving every team a free buyout that they can buy out a player and have no repercussions on it for the cap for next year. So we talk about Milan Lucic's contract. If that does come into play, the Calgary Flames could pay him what would be owed on a buyout, but it not be on the books, it not be on the cap for next season. They could literally scratch him off the roster by giving him a payout. That's just one example. Every team has a player like that in some sort of fashion that they could scribble off a contract off of their cap. So instead of the cap being raised, they found potentially a creative way of lowering the bills, which would help every team have a bit more wiggle room and help absorb some of the impact of what's happening right now.
So I have a question. Does Calgary have buyer's remorse with Lucic's contract?
I haven't heard a lot about it, to be honest, in the media and whatnot. It's not like he came in expecting to be a top six forward. He kind of proved what he was worth on the ice in Edmonton. Calgary knew what they were getting. They were hoping for more, and he hasn't turned out too badly. He hasn't scored like everybody was hoping he would score, but he's come in. He's been a good bottom six forward. He's been a good defensive forward. He kills penalties. He doesn't quite have the nastiness that he used to have, but is he worth $6 million? No, absolutely not. They're paying him a lot to get that contract off the books. Potentially, if the NHL decides to go that way, he would probably potentially be the prime candidate to get bought out. We don't really know where the dust is going to settle yet. They haven't made decisions on that. Back to the Matthew Tkachuk thing. The contract that he signed was eerily similar to another young player down in Tampa Bay. His name is Braden Point. Why, oh why, would Calgary compare Tkachuk's status to Braden Point's? Braden Point had a very successful 3 years in Tampa Bay. His third year on the entry-level contract, he had a 92-point season, and I think he hit 40 goals. He was technically their second-line center behind a powerhouse team in Tampa Bay. He had loaded talent around him. He was a young kid. They defined him as a very good two-way player. He could play both ends of the ice very well, and he's a center. Now, Matthew Tkachuk is a winger, first off. He had about 15 to 20 points less in a season than Braden Point. He's still defined as a 200-foot player. That's where the common denominator is with these two players. His style of play is a lot different. He's a pest. He's a nasty agitator. So to compare the two was rather strange from the outside looking in, that there wasn't a lot of correlation between the two players. I think really what Brad Treliving, this is a theory of mine, that what Brad Treliving was looking at in the Tampa Bay franchise was the fact that a man named Steve Yzerman used a certain wage template structure to sign his superstars in Tampa Bay, like Kucherov. And it doesn't matter how good Kucherov was coming off of his entry-level contract. He only signed for 3 or 4 years at $4.6 million a season, I believe it was, to basically prove his worth. To prove he could consistently be a superstar. And oh boy, did he ever. And his next contract, he got paid. He's making $9.5 million. That's the highest paid player on the team. He lives in, or he plays in a state that doesn't have state tax. So $9 million in Tampa Bay is a lot different than $9 million in Toronto. So he's making a load of money now, and he earned it. He was forced to earn it. He agreed to earn it, and he followed the template structure that Steve Yzerman, of all people, put into place. Now, Stevie Y is the captain. We've talked about him before on our Detroit Red Wings segment. He's a very confident man, and he's a very well-composed man. Like, if you sat down in an office as a hockey player and you're trying to negotiate a contract with Steve Yzerman, you're not going to push his buttons. You're not going to try and bully him around. It's Steve Yzerman. He was the captain. He's lifted cups. He's made his money. He's incredible respect around the league for what he's done and what he's accomplished. You go in there not dicking around, you know, and I'm sure some agents would try to just for the sake of promoting their name and their client's name and stuff like that. He grounded himself very well. And he set a template structure in Tampa Bay that Brad Treliving admired. From the outside looking in, it looked like he admired the structure that was brought into place there and how Kucherov responded to that. So he sat waiting to see what Steve Yzerman's successor to use the same template structure for Braden Point. And he did. It's got a bit of a twist on it, but Braden Point only signed for 3 seasons after asking for Kucherov-like money at $9.5 million. He signed for seven or just under seven, I believe. It was a 3-year contract, and the third year pays him out $9 million in salary, which means under the rules of the collective bargaining agreement that as a restricted free agent, Tampa Bay had to qualify him at a starting price of $9 million on his next contract. So his next contract, he's guaranteed himself that he's going to get paid. And that was his conditions for signing a prove your worth contract in the 3-year term that he did. It wasn't a home run for Tampa Bay, but it was certainly got their team back together under the salary cap. And it's given Tampa Bay 3 years to adjust their books. Knowing what the next contract is going to look like really helps them steer their finances in that direction. So it gives them some cost certainty for the next contract, and it gives Braden Point and his representation a starting point as well. Matthew Tkachuk signed a very, very similar contract where he is making just a shave over $7 million, which is just a hair above Mark Giordano's contract. He signed it for 3 years, and in the third year, he's making a $9 million payday. And under the same rules, that's the starting point for the next contract. But Calgary gets some cost certainty, and they also get a bit of time to rework their cap and their roster to make sure that they can fit his next contract in. It was a very good middle ground for both sides. On the outside looking in, it looked like Brad Treliving was holding his guns waiting to, I won't say copycat, but to mirror image another contract template. So early on, you can certainly see that he believes in templating contracts based on player performance, and that he is not going to play run and gun with the numbers, that you can see that he's a very calculating businessman. I thought that was a very good home run on his side when there was lots of kids around the league like Mitch Marner who were getting paid. He stuck to his guns, he stuck to his business practices, and he stretched it out longer than he, I'm sure, wanted to. In the end, he got what he wanted, and Matthew Tkachuk got what he wanted. The whole team came back to the ice all together. There was no holdouts, there was no nothing. They had their team patched together, and he held out to mirror image another team's contract template. There's certainly a lot of evidence showing his business savvy.
Well, this has been a pretty full discussion on the Calgary Flames and touching on some elements within business and institutional business. Is there anything else that you want to bring up before we wrap up this episode?
I don't think so. I think we've scanned over the franchise pretty well.
So before we wrap up this episode, just have us quickly touch upon the next Syndicate episode to explain in just very brief detail what the direction is going to be for that episode and just a couple of points that you could just tell the listener.
We're plenty excited for the next Syndicate episode. We always get really excited for the Syndicate episodes. That's our go-to. We both love when we get to sit down and talk about those ones. So some of the topic points and some of the little bones that we're going to throw you guys about the next Syndicate episode, which we hope you tune in for, is first and foremost, the title of the episode is going to be, what is the source of the youth movement in hockey? And when we talk about this, we're talking about, what was the shift? What is different in hockey today than it was 20 years ago? The age curve that it used to be was your peak would be 27 to 29 years old. In this day and age, people are peaking at 22, 23 years old. So what has been the change? What has been the source of this youth movement in the NHL? And you can blame conditioning if you want, but I'd like to think these guys have always been athletes. They've always been professional athletes, and they've always got paid to be professional athletes. So the little bone that I'm going to throw you on that is video games.
Thanks for listening. See you later, guys.
See you later.
Thanks for listening to Between the Hash Marks from the Business of Hockey and the Goal, produced by the Power Roadmap Podcast. Until next time.